We are on a classic fence row in a Midwest farm field here. This is like a short fence row that comes out. Basically, it's a separation of two fields. There's a lot of rocks on this farm, and we're on a point. And the coyotes that work this farm just work these edges like this all the way around. And my buddy Jamie historically has caught a lot of coyotes right here at this location. As a matter of fact, there's an old dirt hole set that he had earlier in the season that's caught a coyote. As he was running the farm yesterday, he noticed there's fresh coyote scat right here on top of the old set. So we're going right back in and we're gonna create a couple sets here. By the way, it's a lot of work, but if it's good enough set for one trap, you ought to put in two, at least two sets, because a lot of times coyotes are running in pairs or multiples, and you can pick up a couple in one evening if the conditions are right. So we're gonna go right back in and remake this dirt hole set. You'll see right here, Jamie picked a spot that had a couple big natural boulders in the hillside as a backing. And a backing is nothing more than a back frame for your set that forces the coyote to come in and work it from this side. So a backing can be a rock, it can be a clump of grass, it can be a stone, it can be a corn cob. We'll talk about that when we get into these other sets. They're one a cottontail rabbit. But in this condition, in this situation, he's got two boulders right here, and you can see the old remnant dirt hole. But I'm just gonna go right in and jump in and start remaking this set, and we'll talk about the details as we go forward here. What we're doing here with a dirt hole, it represents a couple different things to a coyote. A lot of times a coyote will dig out a field mouse hole in the field, and they'll dig out where a mouse has been entering, going in and out of a hole. But what we're trying to play upon here is a coyote's instinct to be a thief. And by what I mean by that is a coyote will, sometimes they'll bury a part of what they kill and they don't eat into a shallow hole like this. Any coyote that comes around this point is gonna smell the bait that we're gonna put down this hole and think another coyote has stashed a bit of bait or a remnant of a kill down in that hole, and he's gonna stop and investigate. So this is a hole that we augered in. Some guys like to just use a trowel and dig a hole with a shovel. The electric drill with an auger bit on it makes short work of that. Man, this dirt is nice here too. It's nice and sandy. But a lot of the success of a dirt hole set is in the way that you bed your trap. Well, for that matter, any coyote set, in the way that you bed your trap into the ground, and also in the relationship to the hole or to the source of interest. In this case, it's a dirt hole. In other spots, it might be a flat set that we're gonna put some lure or urine on a backing, and we'll show more of that later. What we're dealing with too is freezing conditions, and we're bringing in our own dry waxed dirt, which is it's expensive in time and trouble. So we have a bucket, each one of us has a bucket of waxed dirt, and we're gonna talk about how to make waxed dirt. But my point that I'm trying to make here now is that when you cut out your trap bed, if you'll make it just large enough to accommodate your trap, but not any larger, that means that much less waxed dirt that you've got to go back in to fill it and make it look natural and like it belongs. If you'll see, I'm gonna bed this trap right in here, and I've cut out a spot for the dog mechanism. All traps vary in their shape a little bit. I've accommodated for that, and I've accommodated for the springs when they're gonna be in the set position. I've created these two ears. This trap bed is bigger than what it should be for this particular set, with me wanting to go back in with wax dirt. But I wanted to show you, if you're in a dry season condition, early season, where you're not worried about freezing and thawing, and you don't have to bring in your own antifreeze and wax dirt, that's a good bed to work with, so that you have plenty of room to get around it and pack it in and make sure that it's solid. And we'll talk about that some more. When I did this, we're using earth anchors, which is a shows you how difficult they are to pull. This is basically a hollow piece of pipe that has a driver that goes down inside there, and you drive it in straight with the tool, and when you pull up on it, it turns sideways and it creates a really strong anchor into the soil. Back years ago when everybody was trapping, the method that everybody used back then was a piece of rebar with a washer welded on top and a swivel. So you'd pack a whole bucket full of rebar, and you had to have one for every trap. And the new anchors just create a situation where you can get away with a lot less hardware in your bucket, which means a lot less weight, and you're so much more mobile and effective when you're in the field. So that an anchor's in there and it's not going anywhere. Now this trap is right out of the bucket, never been set before after it's been dyed and waxed. I'm gonna take my file and hit the flats on the dog mechanism there and just scrape off the excess wax. And the reason is I don't want this thing to fire accidentally. We're gonna talk about trap setup and modifications later. But since this trap has not ever been set, I'm just taking away some of that wax buildup on there. This is a pan cover. It's gonna go over the top of this pan. By the way, you'll notice these pans are huge. This is a Sudden Valley Supply Company, number 4 coyote trap. I love these things because the pan is so big. If a coyote steps off on any corner of that trap, he's gonna be caught. It just increases your catch opportunity, in my opinion. Everybody has, all the trappers have their own favorite style and size trap brand. But what this pan cover is gonna do, once this thing is set and I cover it with dirt, it's gonna prevent soil from getting down underneath the pan and preventing it from firing when a coyote steps on it. This is screen wire, but it's metal, aluminum wire. And the reason we like aluminum wire is it's stiffer than the vinyl stuff that they create for windows and doors. And the reason I like it being stiff is that if an animal just barely steps off the edge of the pan, that stiffness will actually help him get caught. And it works time and time again. It's a little bit tougher to work with and to get comfortable with, but once you get the system down, you'll see I centered it in the trap this way, and I went ahead and just poked a hole through where the dog is gonna latch onto the jaw right there, okay? I'm gonna set it. And these things, don't get frustrated because they'll always wanna jump off. You just put it back on. This trap is so much different than a regular dog style that has the lever that flips over, but it's the same principle. I'm connecting it to the jaw. This is the part that freaks a lot of people out about getting caught themselves. If you'll put your thumb underneath the pan of the trap, like that, you can make your adjustments all day long and you're not gonna get caught. What I'm looking for is we want this aluminum screen to lay as flat as possible with no big humps in the middle. And I do that by pulling on the corners, getting it situated, all right? Now, where you put your anchor is also something to consider. I used to cut out a divot in the center of where the trap is gonna be and drive my anchor in there and coil up the excess chain down in there. But I found lately, I just kind of switched to this in the last year, that if I bring the chain down at the bottom end, I can use a swivel to my advantage, and I'll show you what I mean by that. Getting a trap to bed flat and solid is huge when making a coyote set. See how that's rocking right there? You do not want that. You can pack in dirt to pack it in to make it not rock, but you got to start out with a strong foundation on the four corners. Basically, this is a four coil trap. So these are the places that it's going to touch the dirt first. And you can even see the impression in the dirt down here. I'm going to drop these down a little bit more. We want that dude to just lay in there. When I move the chain around, we want to get most of that rocking out of it as possible. And when you're working with aluminum pan covers, if these corners get pushed, it's going to bow it up in the middle. So just take your time, make sure those are laying out flat underneath the jaw corners. I've got this trap pan slightly off center. I always like to go to the right, doesn't matter, right or left, but I'm about 7 to 8 inches, maybe 9 to the dead center. There's a lot of theories on that. I'm sure somebody's gonna disagree, but I catch a lot of coyotes this way. It works for me. I'm gonna be where I think his foot's gonna be placed, where he wants to stick his nose down in there to investigate the bait that I left him. So one of the biggest pieces of bedding a trap firmly, as far as a little tip that I've taught myself in the last few years, is this outside jaw. Sometimes the way it contacts the spring, it doesn't want to firm up. And by that I mean, if you push on it, it'll have some bounce in it. On these traps that we have that are swiveled in the middle, this is a double swivel. I use that swivel to my advantage by pushing it right here in the center of my outside jaw, and boom, I just created a platform for that outside jaw to sit on. Again, as long as I've been doing this, it still messes with me, these pan covers. You gotta have some patience with them. That thing is bedded in there right now. As firm, that right there takes more practice than anything you do in coyote trapping, is bedding a trap. Go in your backyard and do this until you can cut in a bed, shape the bottom so that your coils sit on the soil and are fairly level. Because honestly, it makes it look easy right now, but that's probably one of the hardest things that you do. And it's, I think, where a lot of people just getting started get frustrated in the inability to do that. It just takes time. It takes practice. The more beds you cut in and bed in, the better you're going to be at it. Now, this dirt that we're bringing in, again, is the waxed dirt. So it's been already sifted. It has no rocks or stones or twigs in it. And it's going to be freeze proof. And I'm going to work it around the outside edges of the bed of the trap first. By the way, these gloves I'm wearing are scent free. Never handle your equipment with your bare hands. Somebody will say you can get away with it. I can hear it now. But this broom was $1 at Dollar General. I'm now exposing where the pan is. Take my hands, and I'm going to use the backs of my hands just to lightly pack in all the way around. And I'm going to bounce it a little bit to see if I can feel the trap rocking in any way. Don't overdo it, because obviously if you put enough pressure, you can make it rock. Just light pressure, pack it in. We're going to go back in. Cover it up, make sure these chunks right here, we'll break those down. Those are just stuck together by wax, and they're not rocks. I'm trying not to use any more of this dirt than I have to, again, because it takes a lot of trouble to make it. We want this to look like a hole that was dug out by a critter. So if it means adjusting and making it look a little bit more natural like this, go ahead and do it. Keep any big stones or rocks off right where your trap pan is in your jaws, because I've lost coyotes where a trap actually has a twig or a stone between the jaws and it didn't let it close firmly on the coyote's foot. Now the dirt that I just excavated out, nothing wrong with leaving some of it there, but you just don't want a huge pile like this out in front of you. It's freezing rain right now. So if this was summertime or early season, I should say early fall, you can go right back in and bed with natural dirt. But I'm just going to put a sprinkling on top to help blend those colors back in. not enough to cause a freeze-up situation, and just throw the rest of this off. You want it to look like a coyote dug something out here, so this is totally natural. You can leave all that right there. You might ask, how deep is that hole? Here's my auger. That's about how deep. I'd say that's 9 or 10 inches deep. It's at a 30 to 45 degree angle. We're ready to bait this and get on. That took a lot longer to make because I was talking too much. But when you're out trying to set a lot of traps and get through a farm quick, time is of the essence. Since we're talking about farms, say this is a 100-acre farm here. There may be one or two spots on this farm that any coyote, every coyote coming through here is going to travel through. You don't have to put 20 traps on an 80-acre farm. The idea is to find the best locations and gang set it, two or three traps, maybe four at the most, and find another spot where everything looks like it's going to funnel through. Pinch downs, corners, we can talk about locations, but on this farm, we're going to do two here and a couple on the next point, and we're done. We're going to go on down the road to the next property. You don't want to overdo it with your time and effort. This is probably, when baiting, there's three scent combinations that we put on just about every set that has a dirt hole location or a spot where we're going to mimic a buried bait. In this spot with the dirt hole set, I'm using a pre-manufactured product. I've got RK's here, I've got Top Dog from Hoosier Trapper Supply, and I got my anvil from my buddy Casey Shootman and Robert that made that. This tip right here, though, is worth its weight in gold. This is old sheep's wool, and you can buy that through the trap supply houses, or you can get it from a local person that has sheep. I'm taking that nasty bait with my spoon, I'm putting it in the sheep's wool, and I'm going to shove that down in the bottom of that hole. That sheep's wool does several things. It holds the bait, keeps it from freezing, makes it a little bit harder to get to, keeps it off the dirt. But in my opinion, the natural smell of a sheep is just an additional attractant to the coyotes. So the sheep's wool with the bait goes down in the bottom. I'm going to pick. I've got so many down in here to choose from. I got lots of favorites. This is a coyote gland lure. Lures are available in so many different ranges of smells. Here we are late season, so this was a little bit stronger. It's got more of a gland smell. It's going to have a little bit of maybe a skunk essence in it too, that we just put a little bit of on that on the back, what we call the backstop above the dirt hole. Earlier season smells have a sweet, like a fruit base, or a persimmon smell. There's some different early season smells that are attractive to coyotes, but something this time of year where it's gonna freeze, you want something a little bit, what we call louder, a little stronger. This is urine. I'm just gonna put a shot of that on the backsplash. This is red fox urine. You can use coyote urine in trapping. I have all the time when you're trapping coyotes. But one thing's for sure, coyote urine can scare a red fox away. Red fox urine will never scare a coyote away. You can catch bobcats, coons, coyotes, and everything on red fox urine. It's just a good scent that creates a sense of confidence, and there's no fear involved with red fox urine being on your backstop like that. Now, if I had plenty of dirt, I could fill this trap bed up a little bit deeper so that you don't see quite the depression that I've got here, but there's no reason to. I catch them all the time like this just because I don't want to use any more of my wax dirt than I have to. If I wanted to, I could also take my hammer and chip these ledges back to make it look flatter. That's fine. I find I catch them just like that all the time.